We'll call the October 17 meeting of the Conway Select Board to order. Let's note that the Frontier Community Access Television is taping this show for future viewing by residents and whoever else in the public wants to watch our Select Board meetings. All right, first item on the agenda is the minutes for October the 3rd. Has everybody reviewed the minutes?
Yeah.
Yes.
Any changes or additions to the minutes?
Look great.
Yeah?
Good.
Okay, good. All right, I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the October 3rd meeting.
Second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Next item on the agenda, we have three warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $333,249, a payroll warrant for $99,597, and a payroll deduction warrant of $25,786. I'll make a motion that we accept those warrants. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Meetings attended by Select Board members. Have we, since last meeting, have we attended any?
So I went, I was at two. I was at, with Tom, we were at the Economic Development Strategy meeting at FERCOG, and it was an interesting meeting looking at a lot of all the green energy projects, trying to review all the green energy projects around, mm-hmm. around the county.
And building, green building, too.
Yeah. And then we had the Franklin County Select Board Association meeting on Friday this week. There wasn't a speaker like the mm-hmm. Hampshire County, but Stan Rosenberg was there talking about legislative issues. And
right.
Steve Kulik was there, so it was good.
Okay.
And last Tuesday, myself and Tom, we went to the Sheriff's Office of Greenville for the Regional Emergency Planning Committee meeting. Which was they've been having a poor time of getting enough people to have an agenda and appropriate meetings, but they had a really good turnout this time, I thought. And they accomplished a lot of good business that way, but so it's good that we were able to make that. And on Wednesday night, myself and Tom, we held the Community Development Strategy hearing meeting over next door.
Mm-hmm.
We at first didn't think we were going to have any candidates, but then we had four or five town residents come in. We had some very good discussions, I thought, about not really adding anything. Well, we added a couple items, but making a couple changes in some of the items, and yeah, it was a very good meeting.
Thank you. Yeah, I did too.
Good. Okay, let's see. Last Tuesday, I was at the Franklin County Selectmen's Association Executive Committee meeting. We were discussing the format for the next quarterly meeting. Then on Wednesday night, I went to the Upper Pioneer Valley Veterans Services District meeting up in Greenfield to talk about veterans services and some of the things they're doing to help veterans, especially those who are homeless at this time. Thursday night, I was at the Franklin Regional Council of Governments Executive Committee meeting in Greenfield. So that my three meetings for last week. Okay. Do we have any?
Busy.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of meetings last week. Do we have any citizens' concerns? No. Okay. All right. Next item on our agenda is to consider offering Lisa Tarowski the position of assistant to the town administrator. Tom, you want to speak on that?
Yes. We went through a lengthy and thorough process a couple of months ago to replace Liz Jacobson Carroll, and our candidate was subsequently offered. She'd been working part-time up in Vermont, and she was subsequently offered something much closer to full-time for her, which she'd not been expecting, but which she felt she should accept. So with regret, she tendered her resignation here. And so it being within the period of probation, I mm-hmm. didn't think we needed to go back out and advertise again, and Lisa had been a very close second for us, and I'm pleased to say that she is still available.
Well, that's fantastic. And what's your recommendation?
My recommendation is that we hire her forthwith.
Okay. Do we have any questions for Lisa? We have her resume, which is extensive.
Yeah.
And certainly on Tom's recommendation, I would make a motion that we offer Lisa Turowski with a Y, the position of assistant to the town administrator effective upon completion of a pre-employment physical examination and an I-9 form. This is a part-time, up to 19 and a half hours a week, unbenefited position with a starting rate of pay as of October 18th, 2006, which is 2016, which is tomorrow, of $16 an hour. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Congratulations, Lisa. Welcome aboard.
Thank you. Thank you. Happy to be here.
Thank you.
I will note that it is my intention to
give her all the paperwork.
After a certain probationary period to bring a rate of pay up to $18 an hour, which we have enough money in the budget to do, and then I will advocate strenuously for that rate of pay. It would bring the line item up $1,000 for next year.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think that once we get good people, we need to keep them.
Absolutely.
And we haven't been able to over the past few months, so.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I just, a heads up that I'm hoping to
I thought you were going to ask her to start taking
happen.
Minutes immediately.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Lisa.
Thank you.
You.
Pleasure meeting you.
Nice meeting you all, too. I should just let you know that I have the pre-employment physical, and I think they said they were going to send it over.
Yes, yes.
To you. Here. So that's all been taken
yes.
care of.
And
I will see you in the morning.
Excellent.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Very good. Have a good
Sorry
night.
Sorry, I'm sitting here with my back to you. And I'm sure I'll be seeing you again too.
Thanks for coming in, Lisa.
Thank you.
Thank you. See you.
Yeah.
Mark.
Thanks.
Right.
This has got to be congratulations
Thank
here.
Thank you. Wow.
Yes. Any more chairs?
Yeah.
Oh my
goodness.
Bryce, we have two seats right down front here.
There's a chair. I another chair over there too, outside the door.
Sure, come in.
I don't know.
Have a seat.
There. Slide it back if you don't want to. Government action. Basic civics lesson.
We always prefer to have somebody block us from the camera, so you can be it. You're on TV.
Have you guys run the Ford commercial?
All right, next item on our agenda is a joint meeting with the Energy Committee. An update on the Town Hall insulation project. Bryce, you're going to take that. Peter, you're going to take that.
Who you are and why you're here?
Peter, it's all yours. Well, I can start some of the details.
We're going to be covering your. Hi. Sorry for all the trouble. We'll be covering your issue at 7:30. So if the Energy Committee would like to come up to the table and
that would be fine.
I think that would probably be easiest for the camera to catch everyone.
You won't be able to get as much money for your ads.
Right.
So that means you.
That chair, we'll slide this
right, on. You're going to be the guest speaker. You better get in here.
Over here.
Yeah, I will.
Take my seat.
Oh, and here's Peter. Are you on camera?
I don't need to be.
Well, I don't need to be. But I just felt that we were
yeah,
in
it's
order.
Yeah, it's okay. Just get another chair. Have we had a successful resolution with the historical Commission.
We've not heard anything from the state Mass Historical Commission. As far as the Conway Historical Commission, I think you received a copy of that letter.
Right, yeah. So we're ready to move forward.
I'm not quite sure just what our next step is, since the state Historical Commission has not given their resolution on this.
And I have the relevant regulation here. If you want to look at it, it says that they have 30 days to review our proposal once we've submitted it. Now, we submitted it, and the Conway Historical Commission subsequently sent them this letter. So this is the communication they have gotten as part of this process. If they say if they think that we need to rethink the project, we can appeal that or respond, in which case they get another 60 days to respond to that. That's the essence of what this regulation says here.
Or if we get no response and for them within 30 days, it's an approval.
Yeah, and the reason that we're going through this process now is that this is a project that's being funded with state money. Mm-hmm. And this is apparently the first instance that a Green Communities project has come to the notice of the Mass Historical Commission.
The first time any project from Green Communities?
Well, that's within a historic district.
Okay.
And the Department of Energy Resources was unaware of this, or at least the Green Communities program was unaware of this requirement within the Massachusetts general laws. And so we find ourselves in the midst of a process we didn't expect.
So we're pioneers.
Yet again.
With arrows in our back.
And we're under the gun. I mean, we have to do this before winter.
Go ahead. I would say that we can safely assume that with the way the Mass Historical Commission has so far responded, that it'll probably be too late for them to start this project without a great deal of added expense doing to tarping and then heating the face next to the wall.
Right, right.
And as this is state money, it's not town money, we felt that better to save that for another time. And we were speaking with Jim Berry at the DOER about what our options are. And he left us with this, is that the funds can be used for air sealing and insulation. And we've come up with an interim suggestion that, Peter, would you like to bring that up since you...
Well, the idea was, so if these monies are spent well towards insulating town buildings or creating energy efficiencies in town, and if we do that in a reasonable way before January, or it probably needs to be finished in January, then we become eligible to apply for additional funds for the next round. We have to spend these monies before we can apply for more monies.
Yeah, this is the money we got from our initial Green Communities grant, $139,000.
I can't see the check anymore. The big check.
Right. Some
And we have to spend that by a certain time, and then we apply for more.
Right. Yes. And while we've gotten renewals, we probably could get another renewal again. But if we spend it again, obviously we want to spend it well, then we could apply for new monies, and then once again this project can, in whatever form it takes, can be reconsidered with these new monies. Mm-hmm. We asked Jim, given the change in administration, what his sense of whether or not there would be new monies available, and he said that the Green Communities funding has been doubled. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
It has been doubled because it's a very popular program statewide. Mm-hmm. And so absolutely no assurances, but he was, at least in terms of how much funding is available, he said that it is reasonable for us to be optimistic if we were to go out with a subsequent grant.
Sure. And if we spend it like this, it wouldn't involve the historical commission.
So the idea was, is there a project in town that we could use this money for that would not be controversial, that would not be dealing with wintertime in terms of the outside surface? And I don't know if anybody's talked with Ron yet about this or not.
I have.
We've spoken with him.
The idea of seeing how far the money goes, but we still have to insulate the ceiling over here, which I think the numbers were $5,000 to $10,000 for sealing that. Mm-hmm. And then what can we do to the town garage? No matter what happens ultimately with the town garage, we're still going to have that building over there. And apparently, according to what Bryce dug up, it's one of the biggest heat sinks of the town. We spend a lot of money heating that place, and there's very little, if any, insulation in the ceiling up there.
Well, there's a few issues. You all went to the building.
I'm sorry?
Are they addressing right now ceiling around the I-beams upstairs in the gymnasium? That giant crack on both sides of the beams to go up?
That would be part of the project.
That was part of the original goal of sealing that up by putting the insulation on the exterior.
They weren't going to seal up on the inside?
No, not at this point in time. We're planning on taking this and moving forward and air sealing and insulating the attic ceiling.
Okay.
As well as doing what work we need to do below below grade.
Why don't we consider for this winter, and I've seen this is up in limbo, and I'm a little bit concerned about reading these interior insulation approaches to the masonry walls, like some of the readings here that don't sound too great about moisture barrier problems and stuff. Why don't we have our insulation company insulate along them beams upstairs in the gymnasium this year, this fall, and do your insulation blanket up in the attic, and by next spring we should be able to tell whether we've saved a sizable amount of money on our insulation, on our heating cost.
Okay.
And maybe we won't need to do this exterior project. My other concern about the exterior project was when I found out just a week or so ago that the money was only going to do half the building.
That's a little bit disingenuous, Bob, because you and I had a conversation at the town garage where we spoke about the project, and I expressed to you quite clearly that this was going to be done in two pieces because we didn't have enough money to do the whole project up sum.
I didn't think you meant two pieces on the exterior. Okay, I thought you meant.
Well, I thought I was pretty clear about it, and if you misunderstood, I guess you misunderstood. But that was only because the prices came in so high on that mm-hmm. piece mm-hmm. that it was the only way it did it. The exterior, or the interior insulation, which you spoke of, was set up to be piece of the second stage of this. Mm-hmm. We're going to do the air sealing, we do the outside thing on the two walls. When we did the second half of it, the insulation upstairs would be done. But now with the delays and having this sort of not being clear how we're going to move forward, exactly what you've suggested is what we are suggesting ourselves, is that we have the money to do the insulation as it was originally specified in that second floor ceiling, the air seal. So that's done. That doesn't become a piece of what we have to do further down the road. Then we looked at where else can we spend this money and where else can we get insulation done. The town garage came up as probably a very good candidate. Mm-hmm. I believe because of the way the building is built, it's going to be a fairly simple project. You've got an asphalt flat roof above that, so it's essentially getting access to it and picking the insulation
Access door, isn't it?
I think there.
It's not very big, but there's an access door.
I saw that. There's a panel right in. Right. That's what I believe that's what it was.
There's not a lot of insulation up there, believe it. I don't know what the thickness of it is, but when I stuck my head up there a few years ago,
not much.
Didn't appear to be a lot of insulation.
So it's a great candidate for spray foam insulation. And it would seal and insulate at the same time, so there wouldn't be more work.
And in addition, Ron apparently was in the process of buying garage doors.
Upgrading the door, that, yeah.
If those are insulated doors, those could be paid for with the state monies as well, Jim told us.
Right.
So there's
enough money?
Well, we haven't priced, so that's three jobs. The ceiling over here, the ceiling over there, the garage doors, and I don't think any of us have priced that out yet.
My conversation with Ron was that the contractor that he's been speaking with, doing the engineering and the upgrade on the replacement of the one higher door, responded that those doors are insulated and you'd be hard pressed to find doors of better quality today. So he's looking at, he only needs one door, the one that's going to be enlarged for where they raise the opening.
You mean the existing doors are good doors? Is that what you mean?
Yes.
They're good doors,
They're going to replace the seals.
I mean, the snow blows in on the floors and everything.
And they need maintenance. There's one panel on one of the doors that's been damaged, but they'll be able to remove the door that they take down. Those panels are usable. They'll just shift one over, so that will be a very small expense just to maintenance of doing that. They don't have to buy product there. But I know that Ron had some funds, I understood, to do this project, correct?
$20,000?
Yeah. But if we move that out of Green Community, that money can stay for other stuff that you need to do with the town garage.
Yes.
You had spoke that you thought that at some point they're going to need to replace the heating system in there. So if we can get Green Community's energy to add a little bit more to your coffers for upgrading at that building, I think it's a win for everybody here.
Is the heat system going to happen before January?
No.
I don't believe so. I think if our step would be next thing is to get prices or bids on on the town hall insulation thing. We've got numbers that I think we can probably rely on for the town hall. And I think our conversation with the contractor that we have engaged to do the outside work is amenable to taking on the interior work, which would probably save some face for us and wouldn't put him at a disadvantage of having time blocked out for crews that he's not going to be able to employ if this project gets stalled.
Does that price on the installation up in the attic of the town hall, does that include that ceiling work that needs to be done in that back closet where it's all wide open all the way up through?
Yes.
Where the old heat, where the old ventilation system used to be?
Yes.
I mean, that's all going to get enclosed for the insulation. Yes. It's just a giant air chamber
big,
now.
Big plenum.
I guess we should hear whether this idea is meeting with your approval, first of all, and then I have another question if it is.
Well, okay, certainly what's happened now is that the Mass Historical Commission is delaying this town hall project, so we're going to do a couple of other projects in lieu of that, and we just need pricing for that. Okay, and your recommendation is that that's the best way to proceed at this point in time?
I believe so. We need to spend this money to make it eligible to get the next grant,
right?
And we certainly don't want to waste money. I don't want to spend it on projects just to spend it.
Right.
These seem like two very good ways to utilize this. It's certainly going to bring down the cost of heating both buildings, so there's going to be a savings for the community operating cost.
That's the whole idea of spending the green community's money is to lower our energy needs.
And the insulation, weather sealing is their big forte. That's what they want to see people doing. It doesn't end up jamming anybody up because it's straight through. They insulate. They know they're going to pay for this.
Right.
And that's what they want us to do. So.
And Jim Barry was favorable when you discussed this with him.
He used the verb advise.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, Jim's a good guy.
He's fabulous.
Yeah. So my question is not having prices, and I'm pretty sure the prices are going to be three times more than any of us are imagining what they are. But if it doesn't, my question is this: if these projects do not expend all that we have available, are there other insulation projects. I mean, that's why I asked about the heat system. The heat system, I presume,
That could be part of it, sure.
Would be something that this money could be used for. Yes. But if it doesn't happen before January, that doesn't
have
help
any problem
us.
Getting rid of the money.
What's that?
I don't think so. No.
Were you at one point considering the exterior insulation of the garage walls?
Well, but we're too close to winter for
okay.
So yes,
that is too close.
That's another option to use
the
it for
yes.
there, because certainly like as the town hall, trying to do insulation on the inside of the building runs into a lot of mechanical work, mm-hmm. and it is not as anywhere as near as good insulating and sealing job as you can do when you're doing the outside of the building, which Bob just referenced on some of the information that we've gotten back. And we initially had that proposed when we had our first engineering report from Lily. That was her first choice. Mm-hmm. But at the time, the outside siding, what she suggested would be vinyl siding. And we said, I don't think that's going to fly. And that's when we moved to say, what are our second option? Was the interior thing. And she did suggest, well, it does have some engineering issues with possible moisture problems and degradation of the outside brick facade. Possible, not guaranteed. There's places that have done this that haven't had problems. Other places that have done this have had some difficulties. When Bryce joined the group, he brought information on this exterior insulation method, which all of a sudden, well, wait a minute, if we can do this and make it aesthetically appealing and make it look like the building that people in town are come to see, we should consider this. And that's what took us down that path.
Okay. And so that's what this picture
that's
is.
The existing. Uh-huh. And working with the contractor, he can add different colors.
This is just an example. And he was also able to find a what's called a Flemish bond is that pattern. So it's not mm-hmm. going to be uniform like this, mm-hmm. But it's going to reflect that that pattern, which is called Flemish bond to the stencils. So even at the meeting with the Historical Society, we went into that he'd be willing, you know, he looked at budgeting this for two colors. He could add a third. We were then able to, he was able to locate that stencil, which is basically what is on what the town hall was done. Mm-hmm. And so I think we're going to have a much better chance of matching what is there than we could with just a plain running bond. Mm-hmm. And I think the key to it is also is adding the shading.
Okay.
I think the getting the color and the aesthetics down is just a matter of making the right choices on colors and having a few more eyes looking at it. I think when we did have the Historical Society over there, they made some choice or looked at things, and so that helped. But the bottom line is we're not going to get an answer back from Historical, the state agency, before it's too late into the season.
Yeah,
it's just going to make it very difficult to do.
And even if they unfortunately have a lot more days like today.
Right.
So wait and see what they say before we decide what to do.
And even if they came back with no response, which essentially gives us the green light to go ahead, I think we're still going to be too late in the season.
Sure.
And we've got these other ways that I don't think it's going to be a bad choice.
Sure.
Will that approval carry over to next year if they... If they approve it this year?
Historical?
Yeah.
Oh, certainly. If they approve the project, it's...
Right.
They've...
We wouldn't have to apply again.
No.
Right. I'm not sure the Mass Historical Commission was informed sufficiently regarding durability questions of what happens to a brick building when you insulate just the inside. Mm-hmm. So...
And we can write them a letter. It's still within the 30 days, I think. So you and I should...
Give them more engineering data.
Get together on that, yeah.
All right. So your next step is to do pricing on these other three
yes.
projects. Okay. And certainly that seems to be the way to go at this time. Mm-hmm. So I'll certainly support the recommendation of the Energy Committee to go forward with those three projects.
Great. Thank you.
Did you want to say a quick update about the Meta project?
Yep. The Meta project. The, yeah. the consultants, yes. So have you been officially invited yet? I sent an email about to you yesterday, I think.
Yeah, this is the October 25th.
So we hope to have a joint meeting of finance, planning, select board, and energy on the 25th.
A week from tomorrow.
A week from tomorrow, where we would have a finalized draft proposal for your consideration, where we are going to propose the town purchase an array, and we're still getting numbers in, but we will propose it if it shows that the money that we earned from energy savings and SREC payments, the question mark is the SREC payments are changing as we speak.
Yes, they are.
And our consultants are working to get to the bottom of what that will mean. If the bottom line is a net gain, and the last numbers we had were a net gain of $500,000 over 20 years for the town, if the numbers continue to be that like that, we will propose that the town purchase that be responsible for purchasing the array, contracting to have the array kept up over the years, put money aside each year to replace an inverter. Our consultants, I think, are being very good and very conservative about what are the bad things that can happen. Let's build those possibilities into the model that they're creating.
Yeah.
So we want to formally present that. We'll invite the consultants if you're willing to come to that.
Yeah, what's the latest quote you've gotten on the solar renewable energy certificates?
So I don't know. I was supposed to have a phone call with them this morning, and I double booked myself, so I'm having a phone call with them tomorrow at 12:30, and I should have that answer.
Okay. Is it closer to 285?
I think it works in a very different way, but you know what? I shouldn't say anything. I don't know well enough where it's going.
Right.
I will learn more tomorrow.
Good. Okay. Great. Gentlemen,
thank you for coming in.
Just quick, what insulation are you aware of? What is it up in the attic? Is it just fiberglass layup on that roof, or did they blow cellulose or something?
You know, I think it's fiberglass.
Yeah. That would seem probably. Great. Thanks.
Appreciate your time, Bob.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Bryce, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentlemen.
You, Bryce.
Yes.
Pleasure.
Robert.
Sir, thanks for coming.
John, good to see you.
Yeah, he's out for the next group.
Okay. Hey, Joe, how are you doing?
I'm so comfortable.
Hey.
Okay, next item on our agenda is the dog officer's report on an ongoing dog situation.
Oh.
The dog officer?
Is Joe Colucci out
there?
No.
Ah, there he is.
Hey, Joe. Joe, hey.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Joe.
Bob Armstrong.
Thanks for coming in. You guys want to come up? That's fine, or it's not. You don't have to.
Are you over there?
Sure. Be the TV star.
Just a brief introduction. This is a problem. I guess it's been probably going on for a couple of years. Got a letter from Mr. Hudson back in June. We have now exhausted our administrative remedies and are coming to you for some policy decisions on this. So if Joe, you want to give him the background on
sure.
the problem.
Well, what I have is I can give you a list of the complaints. Mine started 7/26/15. So it's just been a year. There may have been some before that they didn't complain about. I can't say. You want me to read them off to you?
You can just summarize them, Joe.
Basically, dogs loose a lot of times. He claimed to have moved in there on that July of that year.
And this is on Graves Road.
Yeah, 651 Graves Road. Mr. Moriarty. As it turns out, he's lived there before. there was some family things, and he's been a resident of Conway. He left, he's back. Going there, he was very cooperative at first, and then less so. He said he was going to put up an invisible fence. As of the last time that I spoke to his girlfriend, who I don't have a name for still, she said they now have the fence, but have not installed it, whatever that means. The complaints were mostly from Mr. Hudson and Brian Kizmeskis.
Okay.
I've been there with Lieutenant Unitas, game warden. That was due to the dogs supposedly chasing deer.
Okay.
And he, the lady was there, and she at the time said, the dogs are licensed and they're rabies vaxxed, and my dogs are chained in the backyard, which they were at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't my dogs.
Yeah, the dogs are, I've passed the house myself and seen the dogs with that off a leash.
Mm-hmm. I've only been there once when they were actually loose. Mm-hmm. I've driven by a lot of times trying to find them, but they're very skittish dogs. Two of them are licensed and rabies vaxxed. One is not. They're all skittish. As soon as they see you, they generally run, at least for me.
Okay.
And they do bark like crazy.
So they...
But they haven't bit anybody yet.
Yeah. But they run at the people. Is that correct?
Well, these guys experienced it, so they're probably better than me because I haven't experienced it. I was able to pet them.
Mm-hmm.
But he was there. That's the difference.
Yeah. So they claim to have the fence, they just haven't installed it yet.
That was what they told me.
Okay. What's your recommendation for moving forward on this?
The next thing to really do that I know of is actually you can send them a letter and see if they'll comply with that.
Mm-hmm.
But after that, you have to have a hearing, something like we're doing tonight, mm-hmm. but it would be a nuisance dog hearing. It can't really be a dangerous dog hearing because they really haven't done anything
mm-hmm.
that I know of that would qualify for that to be a bite.
Yeah.
So you can do that, and you have to bring him in and bring the complainants in, and that's the beginning of it.
Okay. How much time should we give them to install the fence that they have? What do you think? 30 days?
I've been trying to contact them. I've left notices on the door. The last couple times I've been there, they wouldn't even come to the door if they were home. There were two cars in the driveway, but dogs were barking inside, but they never came to the door, and I have called him. I can try calling him again and ask him if he intends to install the fence, but the last few times he hasn't called me back.
We can put that in the letter, can we?
Yeah, we can give him a time period to install the fence.
I mean, if he doesn't install it soon, he's not going to install it because it has to go in the ground, and it's going to be freezing pretty soon.
Yeah.
Can we, in the meantime, between now and when he gets the fence installed, can we ask him to immediately start leashing his dog?
Well, we have a leash law in town. He's supposed to have his dogs on leashes if they're mm-hmm. outside.
I've asked neighbors. You guys would be perfect. Have you ever seen him walking his dogs?
No.
That's what I got. I went around to four or five different neighbors. None of them saw him walking dogs. The only thing that I did get out of a couple of people were that it seems they're not loose anywhere near as much as they were last year.
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah, the last time I saw them loose was
about a month ago, so. That's all I can tell you. It seems like he's making an effort. The lady did say they've been making an effort, but their daughter let the dogs out the last time. I don't know.
Okay.
And she said also that when there's three of them, when one of them goes out alone, it doesn't leave the yard.
Mm-hmm.
When they all go out, that's when the trouble starts.
How effective is an electric fence?
Change the batteries and wear the collars, it's effective.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, okay. Most dogs don't like electricity.
Joe, do you have something?
No, I wasn't aware of this hearing. Can I ask what kind of dogs they are?
I don't know. They're black, but they're
like black labs.
They're not labs.
No, but they are black.
They're just a mixed breed, as far as I know.
We've had three black dogs on our property.
Yeah, that's right on my driveway.
Probably the same ones.
That's probably them.
Probably the same.
Yes. All right, Tom, why don't you work with Joe, put a letter together for our signature. We'll send it to Mr. Moriarty and his friend, and we'll lay out a timetable for them to put the fence in and also have their dogs on leashes until then, and we'll figure out something to do if they do not comply.
There are fines for loose dogs. The problem is we have no way of really levying that fine. But I know.
Should we explain to them what the future in the letter, what the future will be if they don't comply?
Yeah, we'll lay it out.
Thank you.
And they got the whole gamut. Oh, sorry, in front of them, you know,
right. Okay.
All right.
Sure.
Let's do that.
And let Joe know. Joe will let me know.
Sure.
Whenever there's a problem with them.
Appreciate that.
Best if he can get there when the problem is still existing. One of the problems with these things is that dogs are, of course, very mobile. And sometimes when Joe's been called to the scene of a stray dog, it's not evident.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I've only been there once when they weren't there, and then they were really, in fairness, they were basically in the backyard just off the property.
Yeah.
That's when they were running down the road. They weren't very far from their house, but it's still...
They were loose.
They're loose. They're chasing buses.
And nobody was on.
Cars.
Nobody
well,
was on?
No, the daughter was there that time, and she was looking for him already when I got there. But I don't know if the person, I think it was Brian Kuznesis who called that time. I don't know if he'd also stopped by there and said something.
And walkers have been... surrounded by the dogs.
Yes.
Yeah, they like stalk you. It's creepy.
Mm. Nice.
They're protective of the property.
Good for the neighborhood.
You know, I spoke to a guy who walks down the road. He didn't really want to give his name, but you can see him there pretty much every day. You guys probably know him.
We talked about him, right?
Yeah. He walks with a stick.
The older gentleman.
Yep.
Yes.
And I said, I asked him if he had any problems. He said, not really. He said they bark at me, but he says if they get too close, I have this. Mm. And now in my notes here, at one point I talked to Mr. Moriarty, who said that he had had a confrontation, that's the only thing that had happened recently, with a man who was walking with a stick, so I assume it's the same man. Mm. And he had threatened to arrest him. He said, if you touch my dog, I'll arrest you. And I said, how are you going to arrest somebody for walking in the road? He's a Northampton police officer, but I don't know how he can arrest somebody for walking in the road and protecting himself.
His dogs are also
scare tactic. It's all of us.
I know.
So is this the kind of letter we should have delivered?
Yes, certified mail. Yeah.
Or if necessary, I can have it personally delivered.
Have Ken deliver.
That would probably not a bad idea. It's a better idea. Personally deliver.
Yeah.
Post it on the door.
In full dress
uniform.
I mean, it sounds like he's been ignoring your notes, your communication.
I read something like this so he can see it on his door.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And the last, I've got copies of the bottom of it, the last two or three times he...
Yeah.
And I have his cell phone number, and nothing has worked.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's all I can tell you. I assume he got them, but...
All right. Joe, thanks for coming in.
Okay.
Work with Tom.
I will.
Thank you.
Good luck. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
Hey, thank you.
Curtis.
Nice to see you. Thanks. I hope you're watching that later.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Gotcha. Well,
next item on the agenda is to sign the letter inviting the descendants of Marshall Field to 250th anniversary celebration.
I do not have a final version of that letter from the committee yet.
You don't have a final? Didn't I see something?
We had a draft, and then anybody who had comments on it was going to send comments, and I was going to get a final copy of word for the letterhead.
Table,
I don't have that yet.
So, table that. All right, next item is to sign the warrant for the November 8th state and federal elections. We have an election coming up.
We do.
And Conway voters heard about it here first.
That's right. Yeah. Okay. This warrant is standard. I'm sure we've done this exact thing before. This is the 17th day of October. And we'll sign the warrant for posting by our constable, Ron Hawks.
Probably best to take a formal vote.
I'll make a motion that we sign the warrant for the up-and-coming state and federal elections on November the 8th. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're not in favor of the election, huh?
Come on, Joe.
I can't play any job.
Just don't watch television.
This has been a very exciting political season.
Did Malcolm leave?
Yes. I think so. Was he supposed to be here?
Do we know why he stopped by?
He was here for the energy.
Historical Society.
Oh, for the Historical Society, of course. He could have been here for the assessors as well, because that's on here, except we haven't gotten there yet.
All right, next item is the sign the certificate of completion for the South River project.
This is a certificate of substantial completion.
Mm-hmm.
This is recommended by the COG and the engineer and pretty much everybody.
You mentioned that some work had to be finished in the spring. Do you know what that contains?
Yeah, we have a punch list.
Oh, okay.
They will do another round of herbicides for the invasive plants.
Have we heard at all how Gary did? He was gonna.
Gary did a wonderful job.
Yeah.
In a very short 3 days.
Fabulous.
It looks fabulous down there.
All right, I'll make a motion that we sign this certificate of substantial completion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next item on our agenda is a discussion regarding assessor's communication, pilot payments from tax-exempt property owners. Okay, are we going to have that discussion?
We do not have the communication.
Yeah.
Okay. We will be looking forward to that next time. Apparently, the assessors have had a lot of taxpayer visitors recently.
Uh-huh, I'm sure.
They're busy today, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, next item is to consider noise complaints and the possibility of land being stripped of soil and loam. Okay, Joe.
Just as a word of comment, the first time I met the selectman in 1976, for the very same reason, I was putting in a driveway.
and the selectman, you were all
wanted, the selectman wanted to know what was going on. So.
You were making noise, John?
I was making noise, and I was moving dirt. I made three. I don't have one for you, John.
There you go.
I need one for the meeting right now.
Yeah, you can take one of these back. I don't think they need one.
Yeah, it certainly looks like it's got a mining operation there.
You would think so. The history is Tom sent an email out to Jim Hawkins and myself and Ken Wimet that he had a complaint about hundreds of truckloads of fill being taken off the Peter LaFargue property.
Yeah.
And his basic complaint was hours of operation, but I became concerned when he mentioned there was a lot of material being moved. So I went on Google Earth, and that's the first picture. And there's an excavator in there. And then the second picture is that same parcel with his property lines.
Yeah.
So there's an excavation of some sort. Looks like it's 200 to 300 feet long.
I think you're right. Yeah, I think
it's quite that. There's a scale of the first page is 50 feet to the inch.
Right, yeah.
So, you know, down on the bottom it's like 3/4 inch. So it's 3 or 4 times that.
Right, and there should be a permit for that. There should be some.
If it really is, in fact, a gravel pit, it should be. The theory, and I think this was confirmed by Ron Sweet, that apparently Ron knows this person. Supposedly he's building a house. He bought the land, as near as I could tell, in 2011. In 2012, he got a permit
from me,
from you for a driveway.
And the Conservation Commission.
I was going to tell you, he got a permit from the Conservation Commission, I guess.
And I gave a driveway entrance permit.
For working near the brook, I assume, according to Jack Gates.
There's no evidence, according to the building inspector or the commissioner, of any building permits as of this point. So it would appear that there is something going on, whether it's 100 truckloads or 10 truckloads. I really don't know.
It's a big area.
It looks like
that's
a big area. If it is involved with a house, and the next page is, or below that, is our bylaw. And it says if you're stripping land, you need a permit. It also says if you're going to change the elevation of your house site by more than 6 feet up or down,
sure,
you need a special permit.
Well, that looks to me like a lot more than 6 feet in height.
Yeah. Now, unfortunately, the land is posted, and there's a barrier across the driveway. And I had asked the building inspector to go in there and take a look around. He said he doesn't really have the right of trespass. He's not allowed to go on to property without just cause. I would think the photos would be just cause, but to err on the side of caution, the last page is sort of what we were suggesting should happen. We should probably not make any assumptions about what's going on, but invite Peter in to explain to us what is going on. We can't really tell from the airplane how deep it is. It certainly looks like it's deeper than 6 feet, but so the building inspector would like to get on the site and, you know, get back to us with a recommendation as to how
if
to
he
proceed.
Don't want to come in and meet with us, and just explain to him that he needs to allow access for inspection.
Right. We can do it the friendly way, or if he doesn't want to do that, then we can get an injunction from the housing court and get the judge to tell us we have permission to go on. And then he would be liable for all these.
So basically you think this is the way to proceed?
I discussed it with Jim Hawkins.
Okay.
And that was sort of what he recommended. Unless you fellas would prefer to do it differently.
No, I think.
I think you think you have. It's a planning commission.
Well, I don't know
if
it's legal. It's not a planning board issue. That was one of the reasons I came to you. If it's not 6 foot deep.
Okay.
It's technically he's not out of compliance. Although it appears he's been moving fill out of Conway, which would make him in violation of not having a special permit for a gravel pit.
All right. Why don't we give you approval for these steps that you want to go in, and we'll...
Can we have Tom set up a joint meeting?
Yes.
Peter come in and talk?
Yeah, let's do that.
The building commissioner will take over once, either when he's allowed to go on the site, or if he's not allowed, he'll do the housing court.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you want that at a regular select board meeting, or
Would...
Might be best to just do it at one of your meetings, isn't it? But we can do whatever you want.
It needn't take much time.
Yeah. Why don't you get together with Joe and Mr. LaFogge and see if you can work out something. I mean,
does he live near here? I mean, does
he lives
he's
in Nashville and Williamsburg? I think that's his home.
Yeah, 29 Nash Hill is
his residence.
Yeah, that's his residence and the place of his business.
Right.
Yeah.
So it needn't be a.
Why don't we okay. see if Joe and you can talk to him first and see if we can.
If you can't, instead of meeting, come and meet with us.
Yeah. Then we'll do it more formally.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Joe.
Okay.
Appreciate you coming
one
in.
Of those. Take one of those back. If you need more.
Can we keep one?
Hey, I get that one. Sure.
For Tom.
I gave Tom one. Yeah.
Oh, you gave Tom. Okay.
Tom's got one. So you don't need that one, right?
You want this one?
Costs a lot of money to print these pictures.
Yes, it does.
I'm your home printer.
That's right. Do you have the electronic version of this, or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You want to? Can you mail that to Tom?
I can. Sure.
Just mail it to everybody.
Or mail it to all. Yeah.
Sure. I can do that. All right. Thanks, gentlemen.
Thank you, Joe.
Enjoy the rest of your evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to see you back again.
Yeah, maybe.
All right, we've got... we have anything on this next one? Request from the treasurer for authorization to borrow from the stabilization fund?
We do not need to do that.
That's right.
We just found out today that we'll be able to squeak by without it.
Enough people have paid their taxes quickly.
Okay. So that's...
Yeah.
Paul. Okay.
Didn't we give her authorization to issue that?
We did, yeah.
Yes, but that was for a conservatively budgeted amount of money. Mm-hmm. And she said at that time that she might have to come back and ask for more. You'll notice this is a very large vendor warrant this time, but we're able to make it fly.
Wonderful.
Without additional action.
Alright. Next item on the agenda is the Open Space Committee contract with Lori Sanders. This is the final iteration now.
It is.
Okay, good. We've done this about three times.
And we're ready.
Any change in time?
Yes, her rate of pay as a consultant is now $60. Mm-hmm. And I think that was the main change. And then, of course, the scope of work is the whole point of doing it, where she's now. And there are five items, and they're really very good. You might actually read them, just because they're right on the front page. They're very, very helpful, very useful.
We had these in the last iteration, right? These three.
Oh, they're the same?
I think
I think they're great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Including giving training to volunteers and providing public education.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, so this is the final contract. We've worked out all the details here. Okay.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we approve the contract with Lori Sanders, Conservation Works, LLC. For the work to be done on not only the Rose property but other properties in town.
And that's funded by their
grant.
It's a grant.
Yeah.
It's grant funded.
I'll second.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Bob. Yeah, let me have this.
Do that.
Are you going back here?
Yeah.
My next item on the agenda is to appoint Donald P. Graham, U.S. Air Force retired, as the Veterans Grave Officer. He can replace Butch Rose. Butch Rose has moved out of town, is that correct?
I didn't know he'd actually moved. Yes, I knew he was giving up his post.
I thought he moved to Berniston.
He's in Berniston.
Oh,
okay.
He'll take care of the flags and the veterans' cemeteries and stuff, right?
Yeah. And the markers.
That was good to me. I know Don, he's a pretty nice guy.
You do? Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve the appointment of Donald P. Graham to the Veterans Grave Officer's position for a term ending June 30, 2017. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, next item is items not anticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting. To appoint Catherine McCool and Giselle Latillion to the Conway Cultural Council for terms ending on June 30th, 2017. Do I have a second?
These residents of Conway come?
Yes, and
they don't recognize any of the names.
The reason we're doing this under items not anticipated, there is some time pressure for this to take place. They're going to be meeting in the early part of November, and they could wait until our next meeting to appoint them, but they can get started earlier.
Fine.
If reviewing documents. At
this was recommended by the council?
Yes.
The cultural council. Do you have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Could they come in and say hi to us?
Yeah. Do you know who they are?
I will ask them.
I think I know Giselle. I may recognize the face.
Right.
Names don't ring a bell.
Tom, do you have an update for us?
Yes,
I do. For committees, we heard about this before, worth repeating. The Energy Committee will hold a joint meeting of the four committees and boards, Select Board, Finance Committee, Planning Board, and Energy Committee in the Town Hall on Tuesday, October 25th at 6 p.m.
Has that time been changed, Tom? Because I had originally put down 7 p.m. That's what the time was before.
Well, there's the two meetings, one in October and one in November. One's at 6 and one's at 7. So
this one's at 6.
It is definitely
6. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Just want to make sure I get the right time.
And the one in November is a larger meeting, really encouraging the town to come once we're looking at...
What day is that, in November?
In November. Oh.
Is it the 15th?
I think I wrote that in.
I have it, but...
Yeah, I originally have it on this for 7 o'clock as well. This is next Tuesday night.
I will clarify that.
So that one's at 7 o'clock on the 15th, November 15th, the second meeting.
Okay.
The first one's at 6.
And that's a proposal that the town would build a solar array behind the school that would produce energy equal to virtually the entire municipal and school electric load.
Right.
The Conservation Commission is in serious need of new members. Calling all potential Conservation Commission members. They have a nominal 4 now, but for most practical purposes, just the minimum of 3. It makes it very difficult for them to do all of their business. It is important to note that it is a regulatory position with real responsibility and authority, and not a conservation planning position for anyone who might be considering it. Also, as much as making decisions locally is desirable, in the long term we might have to consider a regional conservation agent, presumably through the FERCOG. It's not an optimal situation because they don't know the locality so well or the people. But if the situation continues, mm-hmm. it is conceivable that at some point we might need to participate in a regional program. So, step up now. Four departments. The Highway Department has switched to winter hours, Monday through Friday, 6 to 2 p.m. Michelle, the new Highway Clerk, believes that a Facebook page to which residents could subscribe would be a useful addition to the town website for updates. So I'm working with them on that. In the beginning, at least, comments would be directed to the town website. You wouldn't be able to comment directly on there, so that the site would not have to be monitored. This mm-hmm. would be for getting information out, and if you liked the page, you would get, and you followed it, you would get the information. For IT, town meeting voted money for a website redesigned several years ago. I've been working with Roy Cohen on the most efficient path towards a responsive website, which would be suitable for use on mobile devices, as well as other enhancements. Our goal is to enable a town website that is simple to deploy, maintain, and change. The current WordPress theme is highly customized, making for very difficult maintenance, and the navigation is obsolete. We lack locational control of the widgets, for example, for weather. Is mm-hmm. one example. And recently developed plugins aren't really compatible. We have not kept up with best practices, so changing the theme is not trivial. He can do it well within budget, and we're considering the details now. Please let me know if you'd like more information on this.
So Roy would create the site himself?
He would migrate what we have now to a modern theme. It's still WordPress.
Who's going to adjust a website in the future once it's developed?
Right now, that falls to either me or my assistant.
Mm-hmm.
It is possible that we could devolve some of that responsibility. With that, however, there are policy questions about the advisability mm-hmm. of doing that
mm-hmm.
and keeping everything up to date and consistent. So Right now, the people who change things, add things, and when we work with Roy if it's a structural change to the site. But for the content, it's either me or my assistant who's doing that now. And I don't anticipate that would change unless there were a policy decision.
Did you go right around?
There are difficulties with having everybody try to run their own page. For projects, the appeal to FEMA for Delabar Avenue funding is being reviewed by MEMA in preparation for being forwarded to FEMA by the last week in October. So the appeal of the denial of funding is moving ahead. We won't know for some time whether or not it will go forward for this funding cycle, but we will get an idea of whether or not it will be fundable in the next funding cycle. So in any case, it's worth doing this work, and we're working towards the full engineering of the project at the same time. Other items, I'm working on the process for closing out the accounts we set up for pipeline-related activities. That should bring $34,150 back into the general fund. Since the closeouts require select board votes, I'll have the forms ready for your next meeting. This is all under, I think, the reasonable assumption that the pipeline-related activities are no longer in need of funding.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've also asked Frontier about the regional space needs study and expect to be able to free up that $3,000 as well. Finally, I've started final edits for the community development strategy based on that fine meeting that Robert attended and was very had great contributions, all in that, including incorporating the many excellent comments I got from a number of people. It really was a great meeting.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Here's some information I have for you from the Veterans Services District meeting, including our new assessment for the for the next year.
Wow! Okay. Already?
Yep.
That's quick.
Okay. Thank you, Tom. Concerns of the selectmen? Do you have any concerns tonight, gentlemen?
I am wondering about when we go back on winter hours from summer hours.
I'm not proposing it, but
that's going to be November. We'll
okay, November. Okay. Yes. This is around the time we said we'd talk about it.
It's more budget. When we start needing to consider.
I think we need to. I would just assume go back to regular meetings too to help to start discussing the process of how we're doing the budgets. Because I've got different ideas used in the past, and I think we should at least discuss them in advance.
Okay, I'll put a just discussion on for next week. I mean next time.
Great.
Okay, mail. We got, Solarize Mass come to the wrap-up celebration Thursday the 20th. That's this Thursday.
Yeah, we all got that, I think.
You all got that? Okay. We got a piece from our assessor as to why taxes went up. We all got that. Okay. On the 29th of this month, that's a Saturday, there's the fall conference for selectmen sponsored by Massachusetts Municipal Association at Holy Cross College. I will be attending that.
That's this Wednesday, right?
What's that?
This Wednesday?
The 29th.
It's Saturday.
It's a Saturday.
Oh.
Yeah.
You can bring it back, all the information. That's good. Yeah.
We have been invited to the Regional Legislative Summit on Saturday, November 19th, down at the JFK Middle School in Northampton. I attended that last year. That's pretty good. That's put on by the Hampshire Council. And we'll be hearing more about this, I'm sure. Okay. Also, we're being invited by Kevin Murphy of FCAT to do interviews on election night, in case anybody wants to do an interview.
They're doing a project with the students at Frontier. Yes. So it would be part of Kevin's project. As
right, right. Yeah, where they interview selectmen on their opinions on what's going on with the election on election night. Yeah, I've done that in the past. It's exciting.
So they come out the county. You have to get on there with.
No, we go. You go down. The frontier. Okay, that's all we have for mail. Tom, any other announcements?
No, except the next meeting is not scheduled for Monday, October 17th.
Right.
It would be scheduled for the 31st, but
which
that
is Halloween.
Halloween.
We want to do a Halloween meeting. Does anybody have? Is anybody going trick or treating?
I'll be tied up.
You'll be tied up?
They'll be tied up. Literally. No, I won't be busy that night.
Guys, it seems like I might have missed my cue, but I do have something that I'd like to bring up. Could I bring it up at some point?
Your name is?
It's Emmett Vandresh.
Okay.
And I live in Ida Herrick's house down on Pumpkin Hollow.
Okay.
And, I mean, I can wait, but would this be a...
Yeah, no, here. Okay. Come on.
Sorry. So I wanted to come to see if the town could pay to have the black locust trees that are on the town common there in Pumpkin Hollow have the dead wood removed from them. I have two young daughters, they're 4 and 7, and Rob and Emily Edwards, who live in the house just next to us, have 4 children. And they moved in 2 years ago, and we moved in a year and a half ago. So that town common went from having no children around it to having 6 children that regularly play on it. And it seems like every gusty day, the next day, there's significant limbs down on the lawn. I was just looking at them the other day, and there's a lot of deadwood up in there. So I don't know if this is something that the town has the ability to have somebody come and...
Yeah, I can have the tree warden.
Okay, that would be great.
This is on the town...
Right there in Pumpkin Hollow. Those locusts down
the triangle.
By Mark and Liz's house.
All you have to do, you can just call me.
Okay, great.
I can do that.
Excellent. I'll work that out.
That's a good thing, too, because in next year that we have our 250th celebration, we're going to have events on that common too.
Right, so. There's always limbs down on it. So. Great.
Right. Thank you. Thanks for coming in.
Thanks so much, guys.
Thank
Cheers.
You.
Have a good night.
Thank you.
Good
to meet you.
That was easy.
Yeah.
Cheers.
All right, so we have no problem having a Halloween meeting?
No, he was saying he didn't want one on Halloween.
I won't be there.
Oh, you were serious?
Yes, I'm dead serious. That's the night of the parade.
Oh, right, that is the night. Well, what time is the parade?
You would have a lot of candy if you don't have your door open, because all the kids in town are going to be in here.
If you don't give them candy, they get to play a trick on you.
I would recommend we have it the next night, Tuesday night, but that's just me.
All right, that would be November 1?
November 1st.
Okay, do we want to do November 1?
Yeah,
let me just see what you have on that
night.
Just
the availability.
Yeah, it's a month gone already.
I think it's going to be fine.
What time is your event on Halloween?
7.
7. Okay. Well, we could have an earlier meeting on Halloween. Maybe 5:30.
Wow.
Is that good?
Sure.
We can do that.
Is that good? And that way we have plenty of time. Bob has plenty of time to get to.
It'll be dark then, but you will be having kids probably come through the door.
You mean to this door?
Yes.
We can have candy.
Well, if the lights are on, the door
is open. That's right.
The kids are coming in.
They'll come.
And the parents will make sure they do.
Okay.
So.
Why don't we do a 5:30 meeting then on the 31st?
Okay.
How's that? And we'll make it a quick meeting.
Okay.
31st,
5:30.
Well, I hope so.
And all right, then our next meeting after the 31st would be the 7th. We'll go to weekly meetings.
Okay.
We can.
And we've got to we've got to start again with executive sessions on the 7th to, okay. to discuss.
Okay.
All right. All right, I'll make a motion that we adjourn for tonight. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Okay.